Dr. Chikera is an expert in applied next-generation sequencing and bioinformatics. He has more than 21 years of hands-on experience in biotechnology, genomics, and genetics testing using various next-generation technologies. He started his career in India in prestigious research centers, including Eurofin India, while working in the area of genomics, clinical genetics, and genetics in developing biotherapeutics technology. He's the co-founder of Bion, Asia's first direct-to-consumer genetics and microbiome organization in 2019. Over to you, Dr. Chikera.
Yeah, thank you, Kalam, for the introduction. And I just start my my presentation focusing on that sessions. So today we are talking about So today we are talking about the decoding epilepsy genetics by whole exome sequencing, and I'm going to take you some of the important aspects of the genetics and then how things has been moved into that. Before we move into this, I just would like to give you the introduction of the Bion and what the Bion is today doing. So the Bion vision is to become a global leader in preventive healthcare. Our mission is to sequence 10 million people by 2025, so do the complete genome sequencing of 10 million people as a part of the preventive healthcare drive. And our passion is drive affordable, reliable, secure, personalized clinical genetics for making informed decisions about your health and wellness. And Bion is the Asia's first personalized genetics and microbiome testing company who are providing services for healthy lives. So if you see that the flagship products of the Bion is My Microbiome Test, Gene Check Test, a LongiFit Test, and Longevity Plus Test. So microbiome test is basically to discover your gut microbiota, know about your gut dysbiosis, and based on your microbiome compositions, and you know the balance between your healthy microbiome and the unhealthy microbiome, you'll be able to get your food and diet recommendations. We covered the food, 7 categories of the foods in 282 food items in our reports, which include vegetables, processed foods and beverage, herbs and spices, oil and fats, grains and egg, meat and seafood, which are the source for the 4 major components like carbohydrate, vitamins, minerals, and your fats and other components which we use in day-to-day diets. The second flagship product is Gene Check Test. We do the genetic susceptibility test to identify the SARS-CoV-2 infections and influenza infections, and how you can get a personalized care and the drugs which have been used into the treatment and how these drugs are responding to you. And the third test is basically LongiFit test, in-depth detail about your DNA to know about your body, whether you have your genetics favors towards the sports conditions, your exercise behavior, your dietary requirements, your foods reactions, allergic reactions, and then your cardio and gastro health, and all these parameters are included. The last product is Longevity Plus test products, which is very comprehensive products. We do the complete genome sequencing of 30x by using next generation sequencing program, and analyzed 400 plus parameters under this. We scan all the genes, including the coding genes of 20,961 plus other genes, which are involved in the various regulations, basically, which control the microRNAs, basically. So which include like hereditary cancer risks, food and nutrition, genetic carrier, genetic disease, fitness, sports, personalized medicines, and so on and so forth. So these are the comprehensive test of the products. So before we go back to our epilepsy genetics, I just want to give you a few glimpses of about that, how the genetic inheritance is happening, because this is important to understand the disease and how the genes basically and how they are linking together basically. So genetic inheritance is a basic principle of the genetics and explain how the characteristics are passed from one generation to the next generation and how these characters basically or the phenotypes basically impacts on the or trait impacts on your health and the disease progressions. So there are various type of the inheritance. One is called autosomal dominant, then you called autosomal recessive inheritance, then you have a X-linked dominant inheritance, you have X-linked recessive inheritance, you have a mitochondrial or maternal inheritance, and the most important coming emerging inheritance is called epigenetic imprinting inheritance. So in case of the autosomal dominant inheritance, a pattern of the inheritance which the affected individual has a one copy of the mutant genes and one copy of the normal genes as the autosomals. And in that case, the expression of the disease happens, and autosomal recessive, both the copies of the mutant genes are required for expression of the disease. If there is a one copy, then it has become the carrier. So X-linked dominant inheritance in this genetic conditions, the variants or mutations are present on X chromosomes, and they affects both male and females in equal manners. And X-linked recessive, where the mutation which are present on X chromosomes, the phenotypes always expressed in the males. And in case of the female, you need both copies of the variants to become a disease expressions. And in mitochondrial inheritance, the mitochondria is basically strictly a maternal component, which is inherited from one generation to another generations, and all the mitochondrial embedded disease also inherited in that case. Epigenetics inheritance, which is called as the transgenerational epigenetic inheritance, TEI, is a transmission of epigenetics marker from one generation to the next generation, and that affects the traits of the offspring without altering the primary structure of the DNA. So in that case, you don't need to be have a variants present into that, but the expression of the genes basically modulated by these epigenetic factor, which basically control the traits and the expression of a given conditions. So before going into the deep, we just want to understand that what is the next generation sequencing and how these sequencing has been improved from the ages. So earlier when these technologies start launching 2003 and 2004, when it is coming into that and commercialization happens in various countries in a different time points, basically, where the earlier phases, they're generating the data in MBs, and today they are generating data in terabytes. So they see that the leap and bounce is progressing to next generation sequencing technology. Cost reductions into the next generation sequencing technology help us to basically sequence more and more genome, more and more exomes, and pinpoint the gene which are responsible for various disease. So these advances in the next generation and genomics technology, when we say genomics technology, it is sequencing technology and bioinformatics and bio IT technology. So combined together will become a genomics technologies, because the amount of the data you are generating, you need to process this data, you need to analyze this data, you need to store this data, and then you need to secure this data. So this is very essential as a part of this progress in these genomics technologies. So especially this development of these next generation sequencing, which has greatly increased our knowledge on the genetic changes which are happening across the entire human genome, and allowing the rapid and efficient discovery of the various genes involved into the many disease. And genetics is still a growing area. We still, you know, the human genome sequencing, it is one part, 1% to 1.25% of the coding region which are encoding for the protein, but rest of the genome is still a lot of functions which are still unknown in that. And slowly we are discovering these unknown on this human genome by using these next generation sequencing technology. So this is helping us to understand how this human biology and the medicines is basically based on the conditions, that how we can personalize these medicines based on a personal genetic informations, and how this disease biology and the new therapy can be discovered by using these technology. And how we can use the existing therapies which are available based on the genetics, because some of the drugs which has gone outdated because of the toxicity, but in a certain class, these drugs can be reclassified and can be used. And genomics technology, especially next generation sequencing technology, is helping the new drug discovery program. The power of the genetics now provide the insights into how the disease starts and how these diseases have been developing and progressing into the human being, and how we can develop the smarter therapies to combat these disease. So come back to the epilepsy genetics. Before we go into the detail, just want to give some glimpse of the epilepsy genetics, where we are and how it is impacting to the world. So epilepsy is the most common serious neurological disorders, and which are affecting around 65 million people around the world. And in India, there are 12 million people who are living with the epilepsy, and they're contributing 19% of the global burden. And various other countries also have a similar situations in epilepsy. The application of the genomics technology has tremendously impacted the discovery of the genetic basis of the epilepsy and also plays an important role in a diagnosis of the various epilepsy, whether it is an early stage, whether it is a neonatal early stage or a late stage late onset of these epilepsy. So in a discovery where we are in terms of the genetics in epilepsy genetics, there are 1300 genes associated with that, and now we are moving to 1330 genes. I'll give you a few slides that what changes this has happened. And today we are analyzing 1330 genes associated with the various syndrome of the epilepsy as a comprehensive panel. And these genes are divided into four categories according to the manifestation of the epilepsy phenotypes. The first phenotypes, basically the first categories is called direct genes which are involved in epilepsy, which is 84 genes, and they cause epilepsy or the syndrome with the epilepsy as a core symptoms. There are the second categories, basically as a neurodevelopmental associated gene, there are 73 genes which are associated with the gross brain development malformations which are associated with the epilepsy. And there are third categories which include 536 genes which are associated with the gross physical and symptomatic abnormalities accompanied by the epilepsy and seizures. And there are more than 684 genes which are indirectly contributing to the epilepsy progressions. And now 30 genes has also been added. So now it is 1330 genes total, which still the functions are to be discovered, but they are contributing in the epilepsy factors. So if you look at the top genes of the epilepsy genetics, you can find out these different categories of epilepsy and their inheritance, how they are inherited from these genes and what are the cause of these disorders and the gene which are responsible in that. The bold highlighted genes are the major genes which we are going to talk to the next few slides, that how these genes are basically contributing to the various disorders, whether it is a neonatal disorders, PNPOD, which are the gene PNPO, which is the AR autosomal recessive inheritance, and then benign familial neonatal seizures, you have AD inheritance, which is the KCNQ2 and KCNQ3 genes which are responsible. So you can find out the various genes which are basically responsible for various disorders and inheritance, and then you can find out the X-linked also, you can find out X-linked dominant also, X-linked recessive also, and you can find out the autosomal dominant and autosomal recessive. And there are some genes which are still unknown phenotype. Basically, the inheritance is still not known, but the genes are contributing into the progression of the disease, especially early infantile epileptic encephalopathy. You can see there are various genes which have been involved here, where they have not been directly involved in this particular, but the genes are being involved in a progression of the disease, basically. So just want to give you the glimpse of these top genes of the epilepsy, SNC1, KCNQ2, then you have CDKL5, then you have a PCDH19, and then you have a PRRT2 genes. And they are located on a various chromosomes. The SCN1A gene, which is a sodium ion channel voltage gated type 1 alpha subunit, coded by the alpha subunit by this gene, and located on chromosomes 2Q arms, basically. And KC and Q2 are located in chromosome 20. The CDKL5 on X chromosomes, and chromosome 16, the PRRT2 gene. So the till date, there is a various number of the variations has been discovered in these genes. And you can see the lot number of the pathogenic variations in SCN1930 variants, which are directly related to the pathogenicity of these genes, basically. So you can find out into that. Now look at the very interesting findings into this. We have summarized the complete epilepsy database and epilepsy genetics into the August 2020 and October, yesterday we updated the slides into the findings, what are we now into that, right? So in August, we've been working 1300 genes, and post August, we added 30 more genes, so 1330 genes. And the total variation in August, we have identified, basically you can see that 91,000 variations, which belongs to basically SNV, single nucleotide variations, small insertion deletions, and the CNVs. copy number variations. And these variations, basically, you see the classifications in a different things. And in October, you can see the leap jump because of a lot of the genome sequencing and whole exome sequencing have identified more and more variations and more indels basically contributing to these phenotypes. If you look at the SNV classifications, today we are standing around 78,000 variations, which are VOUS. Still, the function is not known. You can see all these variations has been discovered, but still they have not been classified to the pathogenicity later on, as more and more information are jumping into this is going to be basically distributed towards the likely pathogenic or pathogenic. And you can see the pathogenic classification of this small nucleotide variation, single nucleotide variation, has now reached the 14,000 in various genes of these 1,330 genes. And if you look at the indel classifications, we have a still pretty number of the indel, which is basically 1,900 as a VUS and 1,902 as likely pathogenic. From August to October, you can see 200 variants has been increased. And you see the indel, which are earlier supposed to be thought to be a pathogenic, has been dropped out from the pathogenicity because it does not contribute into that later when the functionality has been identified. And from the August, we started basically September onward, we started to adding the, you know, the large structural variation, which is called the genome rearrangement and large deletion duplication, which are lying into the hundreds of the KBs or MBs basically by using the SV program, which we added into our pipeline. And we start reporting into this, and then we have a 1,021 of the VOUS of these structural classification, which belongs to the inversion, duplications, and large deletions basically. Generally, small indel is basically 1-base deletion, 2-base deletion, 4-base, 5-base, 10-base deletions basically when we say indel. But we say when we say large deletion, basically it comes under the structural variation classification, and we have a 2,158 pathogenic variation when we used and report these variation into the database. So when we talk about the epilepsy genetics, you have seen that there are different classification and different syndromes of epilepsy categories, basically a syndrome category in a different onset. So you have a 0 to 3 months, 0 to 3 months onset, basically. You have 4 months to 2 year onset, and then you have basically 1 to 8 year onset in that, and 2 to 10 year. And there are different genes basically. And if you look at here, all these genes, earlier we were supposed to study just one single gene and just see that whether Dravet syndrome, which is SNC1A, is a very classical category. But you have seen, we have seen that in many cases, there are several genes which are associated with that. If we analyze SNC1 gene, we may address 85 to 90% of the cases, but still there are 5 to 10% cases basically which are being addressed by another gene along with that. And we have seen several cases which we will discuss in next few slides basically. Before we go more detail deep into the epilepsy genetics, we want to understand what is the whole exome and how this whole exome sequencing is basically performed and what we do in the whole exome sequencing. So if you can see this left side image into that, you can see the genome is a basically continuous stretch of the DNA. And then you have an intermediate stretch of the DNA, which is called introns. And embedded between the introns are the regions, which is called exons. And all these exons together will complete basically exomes. And in a exomes of the human genome, which consists of 288,654 unique exomes, which are derived from 46,275 transcript and 20,921 ensemble protein coded gene, which constitute to 1 to 1.25% of the genome here, and 31.5 megabase of the DNA. This is where all the protein coding genes in the regions has been basically associated and analyzed. So here is basically how do we basically capture these exons which are embedded into that. So there are technology which is called as the exome sequencing technology, which is based on the probe-based hybridization, then capturing of these regions and preparing library by NGS methods, and then sequencing on next generation sequencing and generating the data and doing the quality classifications basically. So in whole exome sequencing, you take the whole genomic DNA, you shear it into the small fragmentation, and using the probes basically to capture these different technology. You have a agilent capture technology, you have a different technology by three different companies basically, and then you have a 10x technology for sequencing these exomes. In that you have a Roche technology, basically NimbleGen. So there are various company who have a various capturing technology for capturing these exonic region, and some technology only use the exonic region, some technology use exonic plus 5'3' UTR region also, and some use also intermediary promoter region variant, which are intronic variant, which are directly pathogenic variant. So based on the technology, you get the output of that particular sequencing data. So once you captured these region of the interest from the whole genome, then you do the sequencing, and after the sequencing you do the trimming of the bases and the quality analysis, and do the filtering process and analyze your data, right? So we are using as a NovaSeq 6000 platform basically sequencing all the coding region of the gene. 99% of the CleanVar variant are captured. You can imagine all the pathogenic basically which are CleanVar reported variants are being captured into that. 99.3% more than targeted regions are covered at a mean depth of 150x. We are generating 5.5 to 8 GB data. So 150x to 225 to 250x data we are generating. And the capture technology which we are using have a 120 base, a double standard DNA probes which are used in a capturing exome, and 90% of these probe sequence directly hit to the target sequencing, and that's what you have a more and more coverage into the captured region and the sequencing, and the duplicate data is very less in that, and we are covering 19,300 genes into that and using 2 into 150 base paired and sequencing chemistry and generating a high quality data. So if you look at these slides, basically you will be able to understand the quality of the data, because this is very important, and next few slides you'll be able to address the quality issues of the data, because if you have a high quality data, the variant which you are going to identify, you have a direct interpretation of those variants. So in this image, you can see all the quality value. The y-axis is basically quality value, and x-axis is basically the position of the read in the base pair. And you can see that in this graph, basically, this is a forward read one, and this is read two, paired and read one, R1 read and R2 read. And you can see the quality of the graph, basically, which is more than QE20. It's almost 35, 36 into the end of till 150 base pair. And here also, more than 34, 35 at the last basis. So you can see a very, very high quality data. And also all the captured region which has been captured, you can see the uniformity of the GC reach, which is theoretical contribution versus actually achieved in the analysis. So you can see the graph are very laid into that, shows the quality of the data is generated. Now you will understand that when we talk about the high quality exome sequencing, which is very critical to identify the correct variants and pathogenic variant or the disease causing variant as a VOUS in a particular given sample, it is very important the output of the data and the kind of the data is used. If I'm generating the data and I'm using 10 to 20% of the data filtered out, that means the quality of the process has not been so much, so that you will be able to get, you are filtering a lot of other variants during that filtration process. So we start with the 76.88 million reads, that is 99.98% of the total generated read, so very, very less filtered read. And if you see, the low quality read is 6.7, which is almost 0.0087, a very, very, very less read with the low quality, almost nil read with the N basis into that. And two short read are 0.001%, basically it is there. And the GC content are consistent. So at the end, the total number of the read you get is 17.20 million reads you get it. And out of 71.20 million read, you will be able to map it 71.16, which is constitute to 99.94% of the data which we generated. And you can see 0.06% is the unmapped read into that. And the paired and the read which we are generating into the pair, are they mapping into the pair or not? So you can see 17.16 basically is 90.4. So all the map reads are basically paired read map So you can see the quality of the data which has been generated. So once you get this data, you, as you know that, as I explained you, in genomics technology, you have a sequencing technology, you have a bioinformatics pipelines and tools and platforms, and then you have a bio IT platforms to handle such kind of the large scale data. And here, basically, this is very important to understand the, how the data is processed and what we extracted from the data. And if you have a correct and updated pipeline, you will be able to basically address that. So we are using basically is called as a BioNG Cloud version 3 variant analysis and annotation pipeline developed by the Bion team, and which include the ACMG best practices guideline frameworks for identification of the variant in a given sample. Bion exome data aligned to the human reference using the cloud-based platforms are which is mapping pipeline. After that, we do the basically analyzing into the QSR, which is called base quality score recalibration. And after doing the recalibration, then variant quality score recalibrations, removing duplicates, recalibrating, and then realigning the indels to get the correct and qualified indels, so that you will not be spending lot much time into revalidating these indels basically. And once we have this, then the variation pipeline, once we get this, all the VCSF format of the files which contain all the variation, then you need to annotate these variants, and we using this the pipeline in created by Bion team, which is basically gene annotation pipeline using various integration of the program, VE program, ensemble in release 91 model, which using the CleanVar, OMIM database, GWAS database, HGMD database, SwissVar database, and other common filtration 1000 frequency database, exact genome AD database, DBSNP database, and also BionVar in GDB database, which is one of the comprehensive database prepared for the Indian population database. And once we get these variations annotated, all the non-synonymous variants, which also gone through the various impact algorithm analysis using PolyFen, Swift, mutation, teaser, likelihood ratio, identifications, and based on these variations, because to identify some compound heterozygous variant, if there is a variant which is in part of the 5' regions or intronic region, and plus one variant into the exonic region, and they are basically compound variant, we need to see the impact of both the variant before we report into the compound. So this is how the Bion Exome cloud work platforms. You have basically your sample, whether Bion Exome or Bion Genome. Then you basically sequence on NovaSeq platforms, do the variant calling, do the annotations, identify the phenotype, frequency, and classifications, and then you do various filtration process based on a different parameter, whether allele frequency, whether you can use for the different synonymous, non-synonymous, basically pathogenicity basis or phenotype basis, and then basically you start working in the report into the Bion app. Basically, you report into the Bion app. So when we talk about that, how we are going to report it, and these classifications, when we're talking about ACMG classification, so the variation, there are different classification which have been available. So I'm just covering the variant, which is a change into a particular gene. The change may be a causative agent, which will be disease causing, or may not be the disease causing. The change is changed basically, and that is the variance basically. Pathogenic variants are the disease causing variation in a gene which can explain the patient's symptoms which has been detected, and usually this means the suspected disorder has been tested and has been confirmed basically. Likely pathogenic variants are the variant which are very likely to contribute to the development of the disease, but there are additional evidence which are required to ascertain into that basically. And VAUS is the first time the variance has been detected. It is very difficult to prove. To prove the VAUS, what we need to do is the basically further testing and scientific evidence capturing basically, and a family member and the patient family. So if the variant VAUS has been done, and if we do the testing of the family member of the parents or siblings or other family member include into that, that will give us the correct picture that how these variants are being basically, whether it is a de novo coming to acquired into that, or this variant is basically coming from the family and expressing into the particular, and most probably the homozygous or autosomal recessive or the recessive condition or X-linked recessive variants basically goes through this, but dominant also come into from either of the parents basically. So once we address these points, we need to understand basically that how the reports are there and how do we make these reports are clinician friendly. It is very, very important to understand that what we are presenting in the reports to the clinician. So clinician should be able to make out a difference. He should be able to have a proper scientific information about the variations in the reports, and he'll be able to pinpoint treatments and the way forward to manage the particular disease. So in this case, there was a Dravet syndrome, which are suspected into that, and we have a direct pathogenic variant identified into the Dravet syndromes. And then you can find out all these details about the Dravet syndrome, and you see the coverage of this particular gene is a depth of 101 ETX. It's a very high depth coverage of this particular variant. So that means the variation which has been identified into this sample is basically on this report is basically is a correct variations in that. Even if you do the Sanger, is a gold standard testing, is the Sanger sequencing testing, you will be able to find this variant into that heterozygous conditions. And then you have omim phenotypes about that and additional findings, whatever the, if you are getting any other additional variant which are not associated with the direct symptom, but you feel that this gene or this variation also been contributing, because these phenotypes are very complex in a disorders, basically when genetic disorders are there. In that cases, you need to basically discuss with the clinicians, and we generally discuss with clinicians and then report into additional variant finding and recommendations that what need to be done, and also the testing if required to test the family member to see that how these variations has been booked into that. And the list of the total gene which are there into that, what are the genes we have scanned into that, so that tomorrow doctors can see that whether we have missed any genes or not, and if the his interest of the genes are all covered or not covered, and if something he want to do the reanalysis because the data is already generated, he can basically do that and include all these the whole exome sequencing methodology, what we are doing, how we are reporting, and what called the references basically has been used into the consensus for getting these reports, which include the reference. Some of the reference basically also include the variant specific reference. Also, we are reporting immediately so that the latest information which goes to the clinicians and they'll be able to address this. So all the variants goes to the scrutinizing, whether it is indel, whether it is insertion, whether it is SNV. In this case, you can see the SN1CA gene, and you can see this the heterozygous variations, and it has a quite good depth basically here, and then you can identify that variations, the 55% of the genes and 45% of the other alleles. So you can see the heterozygosity of this particular variant are clearly, and then this goes into all this analysis and further reporting into that. So once we address these points and deliver this exome report, and this is how the science is growing, and every day we are adding new variants and new gene discovery into the pathogenicity by putting a scientific a proper scientific workup for these variations. And the whole exome sequencing is not the only solution, because if you want to do the deletions and the large deletion, you have to do the microarray technology. If you are looking for only the single variant detections, then you can look for the Sanger sequencing technology. So there are multiple the technology used to decipher a different requirements of that. But today's scenario, because the price has sliced down, the people does not go for a single gene or go for a only panel. They generally look for either clinical exome or the whole exome. So the data is generated one time. If after 6 months, 9 months, or 1 year, the patient has a different phenotype expression, they can relook into the report and then reanalyze without any additional cost. So that will be a good benefit for the clinicians and the patients, basically doing the whole exome sequencing. Yes, one time there is a cost for associated with that. The next important point here is that how the genetic counseling and its roles, that how do we manage that? We have a certified genetic counselor. We generally interact with the clinicians and explain them about the findings and how can we take it forward from there. And the genetic counseling definitely plays an important role into managing these condition into the family and the parents basically, and history, how these basically coming, and then of the infertility, miscarriages and still birth, so that we can manage these all genetic disorders by using the counseling. And once we identified from any of the miscarriage but the causative variant, then we can look into that next screening of the prenatal screening. And the previous pregnancy in the child affected at a birth defects or any other conditions or any genetic condition expression into the family also can be managed well by counseling. If we do the on time counseling, then we can seriously manage of these conditions very effectively into by applying the different system procedures basically. And the also not only this, we have seen the latest of the genetic counseling not only play these important role onto these neurological or nephrological or gastroenterological or you say single gene disorder or rare genetic disorder, but also played an important role into the lifestyle disorder. You have seen that a lot of the lifestyle disorder, whether cardiovascular, depression, hypertension, diabetes, obesity, is majorly contributing more than 300, 400 million people in India and worldwide. It is affecting a larger set of population. And there are also contribution by genetic and microbiome in them. And if we can manage both genetics and the microbiome, we can basically control these disease and we can delay the progression of these disease in that. And thank you so much for your patience listening. I'll be happy to answer any question if you have.
Thank you, Dr. Chikira. Any questions from the forum? It's most welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Chikara, for that excellent presentation. It was very informative. I just wanted to ask a simple question, like when you were showing the exome report, and let's say a pathogenic variant has been identified, is there a way of matching the variants identified with probably some novel experimental drug or trials that are ongoing? Is there a way of doing that?
Yes.
Not
yes.
Maybe for epilepsy, but I'm thinking in the broader sense, like maybe in cancer. Can that be done, and how is it done normally?
Yes, you have asked a very relevant questions basically. So the two things here. One is basically how these disease has been causing into that, and the second is how the medicine is basically going to work on that. Not only the cancer but epilepsy also. I forgot to add this. A very recent publications has been done that gut microbiome directly play an important role, a fingerprint of microorganism, which is published in 2020. I'll share to Kalam and then she can share it. So that is directly related to the drug efficacy in an epileptic treatment basically. And this is done on a very small study, but it's a very effective study. So the genes like, the drug metabolism play an important role for the efficacy of the drug and the toxicity of the drug. And by using this exome sequencing technology, all the existing drugs which have been used, all the genes have been mapped against these drugs for the epileptic which have been used. So they are very well into that. In our reports, I start adding maybe in coming month that which are the drugs. If the patient is this and these are the things, then what are the drugs this patient is going to be as per his genotype component. So that will be the next addition into our report which we are adding. And this is a very, very neat question. Once we know this person has this particular syndrome, by identifying the pathogenic variant, the next question is how best efficacy medicines can be done rather than doing the random trial for the various drugs. So this is we are going to add on that, and it is very well can be managed by the genetic testing basically.
Okay, thank you very much for that answer.
I have a small just order on the reference genome used for this variant calling.
Yes.
Because of the lot of variation that are uncertain significance.
Yes.
So when we go with the reference genome 38, will it be somewhat it is with more annotations and those shortcomings has been solved in reference genome 38? So will it give some promising results compared to 37?
Yeah, so basically, you know, the more closer of the genome of an ethnic group you will be using, you will be reducing a lot of VOUS on that, right? If you have seen that very recently, India has released 1,000 genome by ICGB and the group, which has been, and this data is already available on the internet and anybody can refer that. And if I'm using that that particular reference genome and I'm mapping that, I'll be filtering out a lot of variations which are polygenic, basically currently showing that it is basically used. And as I explain you, one most of the important point here is building up your own database. If you say BioNVarian GDB has a huge amount of the data, and you know, when we mapped into the consensus reference as today, is it just a calling of the variation, right? And in a whole exome sequencing, we may be calling almost a lakhs of variants, basically, right? But all the lakhs of the variants are not. Even in the KCN1 gene, you can get lot many benign variants. If I'm getting this, so there will be a 20-30 benign variation which will be there. So it is all depending on how you are basically these variation you identified, and how you are basically, these two process are very critical for a success of the output, basically. So building up your own reference is one questions you can use that. If you are using any of these HG39, 37, 38, whatever reference genomes you are using as of the current technology, because you have to see the most important point, the one is where this capturing technology is being used, because there are the coordinates which has been used. If you are using something different into that, they will wrongly map the coordinates onto the genome. So the first thing you have to see that what capture technology you are using. Based on that, you have to, even if they're using 37, 38 in as a reference to capture these coordinates, then you have to remap your coordinates to your build up reference genome. And then basically you can use it. Otherwise, you're going to map up a wrong genome and then creating a wrong variations, basically. So you have to keep it in mind as a holistic approach of the capture technology used for capturing the genome you are using into that annotations pipeline or the annotation which you are doing. So if you're annotating against 1,000 genome, genome AD and other, which are all publicly, or CleanVar is a public database which are there, right? But in our cases, our annotation overrides, our genome database annotation overrides the rest of the annotation, because this is our population database. Yeah,
understood. But do you think that building a new, you're just talking about building a new reference, right? So will it be somewhat a new, maybe, or you know, Asian reference will be somewhat, you know, a new one after the long read technology evolves?
Yes.
So yes. Because of, we are just going through the short read mappings and all. So the long read, when the long read becomes more stable, then I think we can go with a new, you know, individual reference for all this mapping, right? So yes, that will increase the mapping score as well.
Yes. So you have to basically balance here between the technology and the cost. Right. So so the long read technology are more you know, structural variation, as I was talking about today. We are doing that MB's region of the insertion, inversion, and deletions, basically. But if you do the long read technology, you will be able to map into like 5 MB, 10 MB, 15 MB, and you don't need to do the array technology. Right. The second is, as long as the read start increasing, the quality of the score start decreasing. Like you have a PacBio technology, right? SQL technology, which are giving a very high quality genomes. And, you know, the reference genome are rebuilding. And I think new version is going to come very soon, in another 6 months, basically. The new version, which is having a more coverage on the genome and more defined genes in the coordinates in that way of the region, is still not being covered by the current reference genome. So you can see that this is emerging area which will be going. But you see the cost of the sequencing using the PacBio versus Illumina technology is pretty different. It is not reachable to the patient level. Even today's scenario, by using the whole exome sequencing, even the cost is like I'm telling you, in Indian rupees, basically it is 18,000 rupees, is still not reachable to that. So if this cost can go to 10,000 or 15,000 rupees, 10,000 to 12,000 rupees, then you can have a large number of populations, you can screen it, basically. So we have to see the science cost and actual applicability of the science into the ground level because of the cost. Yeah.
Yeah, agreed. Yeah, thank you.
Any other questions? in the absence of any questions, I'll hand it over to Dr. Kamal to present the vote of thanks. Thank you, Dr. Chikara.
Thank you so much.
Good evening, everyone. Here we come to the end part of the webinar. This monthly webinar is conducted by Human Genetics Society. Please be kind enough to notice that you can access the recorded webinar from www.humangeneticssociety.lk. First of all, I would like to thank today's speaker, Dr. Chikara, for spending his valuable time with us and for enlightening with us about usage of whole exome sequencing to find the genetic cause of epilepsy. It was very informative and fruitful presentation. Thank you, Dr. Chikara. Thank you very much. Secondly, I would like to thank the President, Human Genetics Society, Dr. Nirmala, and her all team members for supporting and conducting monthly webinar on various topics in clinical genetics. Thank you, Dr. Nirmala, and all committee members. Further, I would like to thank Dr. Callum, main host of today's webinar. Thank you for all your effort in organizing and conducting very successful webinar today. I also would like to extend my thanks to Dr. Charmika, specialty trainee in health informatics, for his perfect technical support to smooth running of today's webinar. Finally, thank you everyone for participating in today's webinar. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much for providing an opportunity and sharing this information to the August audience of scientists and the managers here. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.